unraveling the unconventional. That's the theme of the talk today. I'm going to make unconventional conventional today. What do you think when I ask you to picture an Indian farmer? What image do you guys get in your head? A poor, uneducated guy, hands folded, praying to the Lord for rain, better harvest? Why? Is this a good image to have of an Indian farmer? Well, ladies and gentlemen, let me reintroduce myself. I am Karan Mahajan and I am your unconventional Indian farmer. Today, before the end of my talk, I am going to make each one of you find this unconventional farmer which is hiding somewhere inside you. We need to find him, bring him out and make him conventional again. Why do we need to find this Indian farmer which is hiding inside us? It's because, mark my words, he is our only hope. He is our only hope. Hold that thought. Let me take you through a few slides, simple Google searches. The first slide shows top killer diseases in India. Today, in India, the top killer diseases are cardiovascular, that's heart, respiratory, that's lungs, tumors and malignant, that's cancer, digestive disorders, that's stomach related. Whenever we go to a doctor with any of the diseases, what does the doctor tell us? Take a few medicines and alter your diet. Diet has today become a very, very important part. But how healthy is the healthy that we are eating? Is what we are eating is healthy? How do we know whether it's healthy or not? Let's take a look at the next slide. If we type on Google adulteration in food, these are the images we get. Have a look at them. Injectables going into our fruits, our grains, our vegetables. This is a scary image, right? And this is what Google shows when you type in adulteration in food. These are the top few images you get. Next slide, when I key in 10 most adulterated foods in India, it shows milk, grains, vegetables, fruits, honey, spices. What else do we eat? Isn't this what we all eat every day? Even tea and coffee are there. These are the top 10 adulterated foods in our country. That's what Google is telling us. One more. Food adulteration and the big C, cancer. It's becoming very common. Every family, literally every family or our friend, someone is going through this. We all know that. When we type in food adulteration and cancer, the top articles from the leading newspapers of the countries, what they tell us? Times of India tells us food adulteration causes cancer, period. Economic Times tells us that 68% of the milk and milk products are adulterated. They do not satisfy the FSSAI standards, that's the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. This is scary, and you can get multiple search results like this when you search this on Google. Let's take a peek into the future. What does the future hold for us? Population in the world is going to go from 7.5 billion to 9.8 billion. We're going to add a couple of more Indians to the world population. And the pressure on the food resources is going to increase by 60%. That's what it says. 60% more food will be required in the year 2050 as per the World Economic Forum report. We'll have less land which we can cultivate. There's global warming, there's climate change, there's construction going on everywhere. Farmers are shifting from villages to cities for a better life because obviously the condition is not good. Where is the food going to come from? Think about it. It's not looking good. Do we have any hope? Well, I told you to hold on to a hope. That's the farmer within us. Keep holding on to that hope and I'll come back to him later on. Let me first take you through my journey. How did an agripreneur like me, a guy who was an entrepreneur in the field of agriculture, became a farmer? While I was in my school, I was an avid sportsman. I was a national level table tennis player and I was Chandigarh champion in that sport. How sports helped me was sports gave me two things. One, it told me how to take defeat. Get defeated, rise up, work harder, move forward towards victory. That's what sports taught me. Secondly, sports gave me my love for travel. I finished my BCom honors, did my MBA and joined my family business of production and marketing of vegetable seeds in our brand Durga Seeds. When I joined my family business, my father told me, son, if you want to learn agriculture, you need to go in the fields. I was like, yes, sure, I would love to go travel. So my first field trip was planned. It was planned to a place called Fazilka in Punjab. Well, when you think of Punjab, I was from the Dilwale Dulhania Le Jayenge era. So Punjab was mustard yellow fields everywhere, beautiful. Me standing with my eyes, with my arms open, and my kajol running towards me. Well, it was August. It was hot. It was humid. I came back home, not with the love of my life. I came back home with jaundice. So I was lying in my bed for a week, 10 days, and Indian parents being Indian parents, my father and mother, they're telling me, son, I think this agriculture is a little tough for you. You need to really, you're educated, so go get a job, sit in an air-conditioned office. Why you want to do this? That's when the sportsman in me became alive and kicking again. The sportsman said, Karan, so what, you've lost the first tournament. Get up. Let's try again. You always wanted to be part of this agriculture field. Now that you've got an opportunity, a minor setback is nothing. We need to give it our best shot. So I started again. After numerous field trips to all parts of India, I was getting comfortable with my new friends. My new friends were hot, humidity, cold weather, and dirt. I started enjoying them. I was meeting farmers all over the country, and farmers in our country are unbelievably nice people. If you go meet farmers, interact with them, you'll see how hard they work and how hospitable they are. So after doing this, after becoming comfortable with agriculture, slowly and steadily the ambitious guy in me started talking up. He's like, Karan, this brand was created by your father. What are you adding to it? What are you going to do about it? So I thought, yeah, that is a fact. My father created a national level brand. Well, I thought I'm going to take it global. So after attending various national, international conferences, I've traveled to more than 45 countries in the world. And today I'm proud to say that we export to more than 25 countries. And yeah, we are more or less settled. In the last 10 years, we are becoming a global brand, slowly or steadily. So now the question came, brand is settled, everything is moving fast. How do we go next? So major incident happened in my life. Me and my wife became pregnant and we had a beautiful daughter. This is not a major incident. 9.8 billion people every minute this is happening. So this is not the important incident. The important incident happened when my wife decided that, okay, it's time we introduce solid foods to our daughter. So she narrowed down on papaya. So me being the agriculturist, I went to the vegetable market, got the best looking papaya, well yellow ripened from the market, and she started feeding her. While she was feeding her, I was making a video, cell phones were in, we were all the media savvy generation, right? So while she was feeding her, I told her, I said, can you clean her face? The picture is not coming that good. She cleaned it, the lips were all red, and there was a rash which was developing. We tried cleaning her up again, but the rash was becoming more red and more red. Well, the papaya we fed her was adulterated with color. And me, being from the field of agriculture, I was sad, I was disgusted. I didn't know what to do, that this is happening to my daughter. This is the first time she's having food in this world. And her experience was with adulterated food. I was really, really sad, and this thought did not leave me. This was late 2014. And in early 2015, my mother got diagnosed with cancer. So even that time, this thought started coming back to me. The papaya is adulterated, mother got cancer. And we are an agriculture family, so a lot of our food comes from our farms. So I thought that if this is happening to me, what would be happening to normal people who are not from the field of agriculture? How would they differentiate between adulterated and non-adulterated food? It's very tough, it's not easy, because they look the same. So that day I decided that no, I have to do something about it. Something needs to change from people who are at least from the community of agriculture. If we don't do something, who else will? So after thinking about it, after discussing it with a lot of eminent people from the field, I came up with this idea of establishing an online portal. That's what allthatgrows.in. There were two goals which I had in my mind when I established this online portal. One was to teach all households how to grow their own food. I'll come back to this. Second was, while on my recent travels abroad, I came across this superfood called microgreens. This was getting really popular all over the world. Why was it getting popular? I'm going to explain this also in detail. Let me first come back to the first point. Growing your own food, how difficult it is. Look at these pictures. There's a tomato growing in a pot. There's pumpkin, there's basil, there's lettuce. These are all growing in pots. Now, if any one of you have to go to a nursery or have to get a pot for your home, what will you pick? You'll pick a flower, a beautiful looking flower. Place it there, probably click a picture and put it on Insta right now, right? But why can't we grow coriander? We all use coriander in every dish. Indian cooking really uses coriander a lot, right? It gets ready in 30 days, very easy to grow. Throughout the year you can grow it. But we don't want to grow coriander. We want to look at that flower which will last for 30 days. And you can actually grow coriander throughout the year. 30 days crop. Why not spinach? 30 days crop, full of iron. So actually the choice is whether you want to look at that beautiful flower in your balcony or in your garden, or you want to look at a beautiful and healthier you in the mirror. What do you guys want to look at? Who do you guys want to look at? You know, if you grow one single plant of bottle gourd, it will give you 5 to 7, in certain cases 10 bottle gourds over a period of 2 months. That means that you can actually cook a vegetable like bottle gourd twice a week for a family of 4 for 2 months with one plant. Similarly, one plant of tomato can give you 3-4 tomatoes every day for a couple of months. Similarly, chili, brinjal, all these multiple fruiting plants. It's a thought. I'm just trying to instill this thought in you guys. And in certain cases of tomatoes and brinjal, the pesticide content doesn't leave the vegetables even after it's cooked. So when you're consuming it, you're consuming a little bit of poison with it. But if you grow it yourself, obviously, you won't be adulterating it, right? These are the few pictures of various microgreens. Let me tell you now what microgreens are. In India, we all used to eat sprouts, right? We have eaten sprouts of dal or chana. Sometime in our life, we have eaten it. Our mothers have fed us that. Sprouts are created in a hot and humid environment. And hot and humid environment, you know, is the best environment for bacteria to grow as well. And in sprouts, we are eating the seed with it. But in microgreens, we are growing it in soil. When the first two leaves pop open, we cut it, we wash it, we eat it. So no seed involved. Why the world started shifting from sprouts to microgreens was because in the 90s in the US and Europe, there was a lot of outbreaks of food poisoning. And that food poisoning outbreaks were attributed to the seed-borne disease. So the world needed an alternative because sprouts are super healthy. So University of Maryland had to check their results on microgreens multiple times. Why they had to check their results multiple times? Because ladies and gentlemen, they discovered that in the microgreen stage of a plant's life, in certain cases, the nutrition is up by 40%. I'm sorry, 40% seems a lot? No, 40 times, not 40%. In case of radish, it's up to 40 times. In case of broccoli, it's up to 10 times. In certain cases, 20 times. It's not percent, it's times. So imagine the potency of these little greens. If we take in particular broccoli, it has a compound called sulforaphane, which is an anti-cancer causing compound. So that's why broccoli became popular. Even when my mother was going through her cancer treatment in Apollo Hospital, there's a poster of broccoli there. Eat broccoli. You know, so broccoli microgreens are 10 to 15 times more potent than actually the real broccoli. How do they taste? They taste the same. You'll be shocked. These miniature plants, microgreens, radish tastes like radish, onion tastes like onion, cauliflower broccoli tastes like cauliflower broccoli. So there's taste, there is health, there is nutrition. Broccoli takes 90 to 100 days to grow. Broccoli microgreens are ready in 15 days. Radish takes say 40 days to grow. Radish microgreens are ready in 5 days. One sixth the time than their mature counterpart, and up to 40 times more nutrition. What I was highlighting, let me show you that in the slide as well. Red cabbage, very popular. Whatever is red, it's supposed to be anti-cancerous. Red as a compound has anti-cancerous properties. And microgreens are very high in antioxidants. We all know how important that is. And second thing which is getting really popular these days is that your body needs to be alkaline. Intermittent fasting, everything is happening, catching up. What do they make your body go through? They make your body alkaline, from acidic to alkaline. So microgreens are alkaline in nature. More your body is alkaline, less disease you'll get. So red cabbage has 40 times more vitamin E. Red cabbage microgreens have 40 times more vitamin E than the normal red cabbage.
Please take it.
Vitamin C 6 times. Coriander has B carotene 3 times more than the normal coriander. And normal coriander takes 30-35 days to grow. This is ready in 7-8 days. Basil is getting very popular, right? Italian food, basil is used a lot. Vitamin K, 8 times more than fully grown basil, which is a long duration crop. And this basil microgreens are ready in 15-20 days. So it's actually a very quick way of gaining health. So isn't it shocking and exciting for you? I'm sure none of you ever thought about microgreens like that. But when I got to know about them, I had one thought in mind. I need to introduce microgreens to India. So through all that growth, we introduced microgreens to India. Now we have a startup with my wife that's called Leaf and Life, where we are supplying microgreens to households in the Chandigarh Tri-City. And a lot of startups are coming up in Delhi, Bombay, all metro cities. There are a lot of startups which are coming up and growing and supplying microgreens. It's a superfood which you all need to adapt in your life. Why we call them magic greens? Because of the health factor. So two factors again. To grow our own basic vegetables and greens is very easy. Rather than growing a flower, grow vegetable. Secondly, adopt microgreens. Google it. Google has everything it has. You need to know about microgreens. Whatever I've said here, Google has all the basic data and facts. So ladies and gentlemen, me, Karan Mahajan, now your conventional Indian farmer, would like to conclude by saying, what we eat literally becomes us. Eat wisely. Feed your family wisely. Become your own and your family's superhero. Become a farmer. Thank you and God bless.